أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف وسيد المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن صار على نهجه إلى يوم الدين. Indeed, the praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May the peace and blessings be upon His final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Before I begin, there's just a few things I wanted to mention. And firstly and lastly, that all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He has gathered us here to talk about what is, of course, the most important topic. And it's a salah, the prayer, and its importance. It is the first time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has enabled me to come to this masjid. It's not really that far away from me. So I would like to thank Sheikh Abdul Samad and the committee for agreeing for me to come. There's a green light for me to come, which is a good sign, inshallah ta'ala. And also I would like to give recognition as well to where, you know, recognition is due. That I think maybe this is the closest I've sat with on something like a platform like this for maybe more than 8 years. I think maybe close to 10 years. It's maybe 10 years ago that I sat in a similar position to Sheikh Tawfiq in like this this position, because we were in the same class. And I think I look back to what it was then and what it is now, and the achievement, of course, the grace and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Firstly. But the great achievement that Allah has enabled Sheikh Tawfiq to do, really, in establishing Mercy Mission and all the sub-projects that have gone under that, like there's a National Zakah Foundation and Al-Kawthar, of course, which is well known. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward Sheikh Tawfiq, and may Allah all reward all the instructors and all of those who have participated in such a noble effort. No. Before I begin into the topic about the habits of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam concerning the salah specifically, I think there was a few things I wanted to mention so as we can, inshallah ta'ala, benefit from his beautiful and best of guidance concerning the salah. And first I wanted to note the importance of following the habits of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and knowing the importance of following his sunnah alayhi salatu wasalam, especially in a time where now that all of us, we are claiming to love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we will demonstrate our love to the Prophet alayhi wasalam in a number of different ways. But the most important criterion in showing our love and demonstrating our love for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is adhering to his authentic sunnah. And Allah jalla wa ala, He tells us, "Qul in kuntum tuhibbun Allah," that say, "If indeed you love Allah, fattabi'uni yuhibbukum Allah," then follow me, and you will attain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So following the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a means for us to gain the love of Allah jalla wa ala. This is the ultimate goal for us, to gain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and in turn attain the ultimate reward by being entered into the paradise. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the success and the guidance to follow the authentic sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A man, he was praying in the masjid, and he prayed after, maybe a well-known example, he prayed after the sunrise, and he was offering a number of prostrations and ruku' and remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after the fajr. Sa'id ibn Musayyib rahimahullah ta'ala, he rebuked him for doing this, rebuked him for praying at this time. And then the man said, "Are you rebuking me? You're telling me off because I'm praying?" He said, "I'm not rebuking you for the fact that you are praying, but I'm rebuking you the fact that you are going against the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So even though that the action that the person is claiming to be correct may be correct, but the timing of it and how that you're going to do that is of the utmost importance. So how you demonstrate your following the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is of the utmost importance. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the beginning of his prophethood to the end, you will find that the salah, that the prayer, has an extremely important significance. That is said that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, Ya ayyuhal muddathir, O the one who is covered in garments, that he said to his wife Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, that is it. The time for rest, the time for sleeping and relaxing is over. قُمْ فَأَنْذِرْ. Allah Jalla wa'ala then commanded the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to stand up and to warn his people. From this time until the very last moments of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's life, you will find that the prayer and everything that was around the prayer was given priority, and that the focus was on the prayer. Now I'm not going to go into the wider aspects of the importance of the prayer, and so that will come later inshaAllah ta'ala. But I just wanted to mention the guidance of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam within the prayer itself. That if you go through the prayer from the very beginning, it is not just a set of bodily movements. Because that there are many of us, you'll find that they do the same ruku', they do the same sujood. Everything is exactly the same from the beginning to the end. But you might find that one has the reward that reaches up to the heavens, and another person has no reward, and another person, the salah doesn't reach above their neck, even though that they're doing the same actions. So the point here is not, of course it is important, صلوا كما رأيتموني, or صلي, pray as you have seen me, as you have seen me pray, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us. But it's not just merely actions. It's not just merely that external position that we are going to focus on, which many of us that we do. We just focus on the external part of the prayer, which is important, but not at a sacrifice about the internal actions. And as many of the ulama rahimahullah ta'ala have said, that the actions, or the internal actions, are of greater reward and greater significance of those outer actions. Because the foundation of any outer action, it starts with that inner action, with your intention, inside. So when we are focusing on straightening the lines, which is important, and maybe when we want to focus on making sure that our bodily parts on the right, our shoulders and our feet, are touching and chasing people, but yet somehow we have forgotten the essence of our salah. In you concentrating and humbling yourself and fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within those movements. And as Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu stated, that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he would perform his salah, that every morsel of flesh, every tendon, every hair on his body, alayhi salatu wasalam, was in pure servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the kind of habits, and these are the kind of things that I want to make sure that are part of my prayer. That it's just not merely actions, but those actions are in fact me showing and manifesting my ibadah, my servitude, and my yielding to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the kind of habits that I want to ensure are part of my prayer. Not just, as I mentioned, those things which you see with the eye. But I want to make sure that it begins with inside. That when I pray, that my bodily parts are truly worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught us how to pray. So whenever you make tasbih, whenever you say subhanallah, subhana rabbi al-a'la, subhanallah al-azim, it is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who taught you to say that. whether you are in ruku' or whether you are in sujood. And that when you are standing in salah, that you read al-fatiha, and that you may recite another surah. And that is because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us that. And it is adhering to these things, which is what that will give you success and a qubool from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bi-ithnillah. When you look at the salah itself, and you look at your own salah, what habits do you have in your salah? Now that habit, when you think of a habit, is that it reoccurs quite frequently. The same thing that you keep doing. But within the salah, it is good to have good habits. And even note that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam showed us particular adhkar, particular things to do and say throughout the salah, that there is some scope within the salah itself for you to do more than one thing, for example, or not to stick to the same thing. So after you raise your hands, you say, Allahu Akbar. What is the first type of dua that you say? Is it that you say the same dua al-istiftah every single time? Or is it that you find that you may change it from time to time? By saying the same thing, you may become a little heedless of the meaning of what you are saying. If indeed you know exactly what you're saying in the first place. But the habit of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that he would change the dua al-istiftah, the opening supplication, from time to time. At times it involves praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala completely. At other times it involves you asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. And on other occasions it may involve both, praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and asking for forgiveness. This was his habit, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the dua al-istiftah. This is a habit we should try to bring within our own salah. And not just to restrict yourself to one dua, and that you speed through it so quickly, you think to yourself, did I actually say it? So try to say another dua, where you will concentrate on what you are saying. And after the recitation of al-fatiha, for example, that you will not restrict yourself just to the small surah. Even though it may be, if you're not in the masjid and you're in the morning, Fajr for example, that you restrict yourself for no good reason to the small surah. Rather, what was the habit of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarding Salat al-Fajr? That he alayhi wasallam would elongate it slightly. That is the habit of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam concerning the Fajr prayer. And likewise the other prayers, like the Dhuhr prayer, and the Asr prayer, and the Maghrib. Well, what was the habit of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam concerning these? Now in the short time that I have with you, we don't have the time for me to give you for answers for every single salah. This is what you should be doing. But at the very least, I'm stimulating some thought process within yourself, that yes, what was the habit or the practice or the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam concerning these prayers? When you go into, for example, a ruku', or you go into sujood, what are the different adhkar, the different supplications that you can possibly say at those times? Or will you restrict yourself to Subhana Rabbi al-Azim? وَمَا عَظَمَ الْكَلِمَةِ. Not for us to belittle that statement. For you to make such a statement in ruku', there's nothing better for you to say. فَأَمَّا الرُّكُوعُ فَعَظِّمُ فِيهِ الرَّبِّ. For us, for your bowing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so glorify or exalt your Lord. That is the best statement that you can make. But along with that, that there are other supplications that you can make. And likewise in sujood, saying Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Glory be to Allah the Most High. The best supplication you can say is that. But along with that, there are other things that you can say. And it was the habit of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to say other things. Which reminds me of a narration that a young Sahabi radiallahu anhu, that he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu, that this young Sahabi was paying attention to what the Prophet ﷺ was saying in sujood. And at times that the Prophet ﷺ could be heard saying many, many different things while in sujood. This young Sahabi who showed a lot of endeavor and desire to learn what was said in the prostration, that he said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Mu'adh, that I do not have the eloquence of that what you, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Mu'adh, that you say in your sujood. I don't have the eloquence. My language is not as wide as yours. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, what is it that you say fi sujoodik? What do you say while you are prostrating? He said quite simply, I say, Allahumma inni as'aluka al-jannata wa'udhu bika min an-nar. O Allah, I ask you for the paradise and I seek refuge from the fire. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, hawlahuma nudandin. Everything that we are saying is around these two things. So at the very least, if you haven't memorized lots and lots and lots and lots of adhkar, that along with your statement, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, that you would make that statement, Allahumma inni as'aluka al-jannah wa a'udha bika min an-nar. And it was the habit of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to teach the companions and to address the companions in the way that they understood, and to make them feel part of the jama'ah, part of the society, part of that they felt as though that they could participate in achieving some reward. Not that they had to reach a certain level and then they could start accumulating deeds. But regardless of what level that you are at, that there is an opportunity for you to attain reward and mercy and blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we look at this, we will find that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam again gave another advice concerning the habit of the salah. Not just restricting yourself to one thing within the salah. A man, he came into the masjid and he prayed. And there's a well-known hadith. And it is known as the hadith of the man who prayed badly. Does anybody know his name, by the way? Of that companion. Does anybody know the hadith? The man, he came into the masjid and he prayed, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him to go back three times and to repeat the prayer. And he said at the end, La uhsinu ghayru dhalik. I cannot do any better than that. Do you know the hadith? Do you know the hadith, Musharak? Do you know the hadith?
Yes.
Does anybody know the name of that companion?
No.
Tayyib. At the end, inshallah ta'ala, if somebody hasn't given the answer, I'll give you the answer, inshallah, at the end. So it gives you an opportunity to Google it. This companion, radiallahu anhu, in the manner that he prayed, it was at a level that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam deemed it that he needed to repeat his prayer. At the end he said, I can't do any more than that. Well, I need anything different from that. So then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught him. And he taught him how to pray. Did he miss out his ruku'? No. Did he miss out his sujood? No. Did he miss out beginning Allahu Akbar? No. Did he miss out taslim at the end? No. So he didn't miss out what you would physically see how a person prays. But that important ingredient was at-tama'in, tranquility within the prayer. The ability to be calm within the salah, between each movement. That when you're standing and you're going to rukur, and then you stand up, and then you go back into a prostration, each of those is an independent movement that needs to be completed, and has its haqq, and has its right. That the worst thief is who? One who steals from his salah. So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught this companion, that make it a habit within your salah, within your prayer, to make sure that every movement of your salah is given its haqq, is given its right. That when you stand, that you stand hatta tatma'in. And when you're going to ruku', that you're going to ruku' hatta tatma'in. Tatma'in until you are calm, or until you are tranquil. And when you stand up, you stand in that position, حَتَّى تَطْمَئِن. One of the secrets of the salah, that many of us, it bypasses us. Another example, that Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she stated that whenever a matter or an issue would bother the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, would make him think deeply, فَزِعَ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ. Whenever something came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, serious matter, the first thing that he would go to, a salah, the prayer, to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was his habit. Now for many of us, if I have a problem, a dunyawi problem, a family problem, do I go for salah? Or will I go to something else? Maybe I think I'm going to fix the problem. The one who's going to fix the problem is the one who gave you the problem in the first place. One who decreed that matter for you at the very beginning. Allah Jalla wa'ala. So when an issue came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he would immediately salah, to salah. As it is also mentioned by the Ummahat al-Mu'mineen, the mothers of the believers, radiallahu ta'ala anhum, that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would go into the house, كَانَ عَلَى خِدْمَةِ أَهْلِكَ, that he was at the service of his family. Not like a rajulun jabbar, leader, ordering people around. This was not the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam within the home. But he, alayhi salatu wasalam, from the time that he would leave his house, being at the service of the people, and the service of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he would come home, and then he would be at the service of his family. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And even that, Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he stated, that even within that time, he would split into different times, when he was at his home. And he would still designate a time where people could visit him, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he would be at the service of the people. But Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anhu stated, فَإِذَا أَذَّن, when adhan was made, it was though he did not know anybody. That was it. That when the adhan was called, it was time to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in salah. Everything was then put on hold. Everything was then to wait. Because now is the time to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those 5 daily prayers. The example that comes to my mind is that act of ibadah, that act of worship, for everyone who is sitting here in front of me, the one act of ibadah will never stop. That act of ibadah that will always remain with you. If you don't have the money, you don't pay zakah. If you don't have the money and the means, you don't perform hajj. If you're ill or you're sick or you're a traveler, you don't fast. Whether you are rich or poor, you're resident or traveler, the prayer will remain with you. So when the adhan was made, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he turned to prayer immediately. Even you find a more compassionate side, a softer side, in how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his offering salah, in knowing his surroundings, that he would carry his granddaughter, Umayyah, the daughter of Zainab, radiallahu anhu, in the salah, a small child, that he sallallahu alaihi wasallam would pick up his daughter, his granddaughter, and place her on his shoulder. And then while he went into the rukuh, he placed her in front of him, and then he alayhi salam, pick her up again. Another example, either Hassan or Hussein, radiallahu anhum, climbing over the back of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam while in sujood. Until on one occasion, that one of the companions thought, because the sujood was quite long, that something had happened. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed that companion that he wanted to give Hassan al Hussein their haqq, their right, in wanting to play and then to move off. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had an awareness within his salah. And even the person who is leading the prayer, the imam, the leader of the community, when he's leading the prayer, فَلْيُخَفِّفْ, then let him pray lightly on the people. Let the people enjoy praying behind the imam. Mu'adh ibn Jabal, from one of the most knowledgeable of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, very beloved to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, used to lead the people in Banu Salama in Quba area, not too far away from the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He used to lead them in Salat al-Isha. And on one occasion he prayed Salat al-Isha quite long. In one narration he said almost the length of Surah al-Baqarah. Until one of the people who was a fallah, he was a farmer. It was so long he left the prayer, he prayed on his own. And he said, I'm going to raise this issue to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Mu'adh said, you are a hypocrite. You left the prayer. So the man, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and told of the Prophet alayhi wasallam what had happened. He said to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Mu'adh, فَتَّانًا أَنْتَ يَا مُعَاذ. Are you one who is creating fitna, ya Mu'adh? Because within your jama'ah that there is a mariyah, that maybe it's a sick person, or kabir fi sin, somebody who's older, or is young, or even a woman with her child. So if any one of you is going to lead the prayer, فَلْيُخَفِّفْ, then lighten the prayer. Not to the extent that it goes against the sunnah, in us not knowing maybe what you should recite in Salat al-Isha, for example. So there is that balance between knowing the sunnah in both areas, because you don't want to go from one extreme to another. And it was the habit of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in when giving advice, that not only that he sallallahu alaihi wasallam would give you an advice that was needed for you right at that particular time, but he would give you an advice, something extra, something directly linked to that issue. Like when the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, some of them came, that they used to be fishermen. And they used to sometimes carry a small amount of water. That if they said, if we drank this water, that we would, or make wudu' with this water, that we would become thirsty, because we cannot make wudu' with the seawater. Are we permitted to make wudu' with the seawater? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you can. The water is tahur, is pure. The answer has been given. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, and also its dead is pure for you as well. The dead fish, the things that you find in the sea, if it doesn't cause you any harm, that is also permissible for you. So it is the habit of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in when giving advice to that matter that was needed, and at times giving something extra that was needed. But the importance of salah, the prayer, was given great significance. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to make sure that the prayer was an intrinsic part, not of only his blessed life sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but the companions radiallahu anhum, that this idea or this understanding was passed on to them too, and passed on to their families. When you look at the supplications of the prophets alayhi salatu wasalam, from them Ibrahim alayhi salam, he supplicated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in making sure that his family was steadfast upon the prayer. And that he sallallahu alayhi wasalam was found on an occasion, because it was his habit alayhi salatu wasalam to establish the night prayer. Establishing the night prayer was part of his sunnah, alayhi salatu wasalam. To the extent that Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you are whom Allah jalla wa ala has forgiven ما تقدم من ذنبك وما تأخر. Your previous and your sins to come, they've all been forgiven. But yet you still place yourself in this position where... And the answer was what? Should I not be a thankful servant? Should I not be a thankful servant? So it is these habits that I want to instill in my life to ensure that I am a grateful servant. And that it will enable me to have a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for all the people that are on this earth, regardless of their religion, whatever way that they follow, that there is nobody that can really have a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like the Muslim does. No one can equal it. Not even close. Because from the moment that you wake up, that there is adhkar for you. And all the things that follow, going into the bathroom, coming out of the bathroom, putting on your clothes, making wudu, leaving your house, going into the masjid, come out of the masjid, go back into your home. How many adhkar I've just mentioned there? That's maybe in the space of half an hour, 45 minutes. No one has a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like the true believer. And that there is no one who feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is no person closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No one will ever pray like him. No one will fast like him. No one will make the hajj like him. No one will be like him in his ibadah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But he is our qudwa. He is our role model. And he is the way to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That there is no other way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except through the way and the habits and the authentic sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And any ignorance that we may have, any jahl that any one of us may possess, and all of us that we are ignorant in many things, this can only be extinguished. This can only be removed by knowledge. And what we mean here by knowledge is knowing the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and knowing the authentic sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That there is no success in this life except by holding on to those two things. There is no way to Jannah, there is no way to paradise except that you adhere to those two revelations. The book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now many books, many writings have been compiled concerning the prayer of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From the earliest books of Al-Hadith, Muwatta of Imam Malik, and the other six books of Hadith, Al-Bukhari, Muslim, and the four Sunan, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and Nasa'i, all have Kitab al-Salah, the book of prayer. How the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would pray. From the time that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would raise his hands, saying Allahu Akbar, to the time that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. None of this knowledge is hidden from us. Nothing is hidden in caves or vaults. It is all there for you in a language that you can understand. Whether it is in the language that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke, the pure and beautiful Arabic language, or in translating the meanings into other languages like English or French or Urdu. There is no excuse for any one of us to be ignorant concerning the habits of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, concerning what is your conversation and your link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 5 times a day. At the very least, that when you say and you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim, O Allah, guide us to the straight path. Is that because you are dhalimuddin? Is that because you are misguided and you are misguiding others that you are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance? Or is it actually that you are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are recognizing that Allah jalla wa ala has guided you to al-Islam, but you are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep you firm upon the straight path and to give you knowledge and success to remain on that straight path? This is what the intended meaning is, from its intended meanings. Oh Allah, keep me steadfast upon this deen. Give me knowledge. Knowledge of the Qur'an and knowledge of the authentic sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are just a few words that I just wanted to mention concerning the importance of us adhering to the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam within our salah. And anything that I have said correct is from the tawfiq of Allah jalla wa ala. And I hope that this first and foremost is a reminder for myself to educate myself concerning the intricacies of my prayer, as you should be also focusing on the intricacies of your prayer, that you do not move your foot, your hand, your head, or anything in your salah except that you have been directed to do so. How beautiful it would be that you are in fact praying exactly the same way that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, or the same salah as Umar ibn Khattab or any of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. That you are 1430 or 40 years later, you're praying exactly the same salah. What an honor it is if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honors you with a salah that is conforming to the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to pray the way that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove all forms of arrogance and jealousy or whatever diseases of the heart that one may have in stopping us to follow the authentic sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us a gathering in the places of Jannah, that we may one day, inshallah ta'ala, talk about such a gathering that we have now. Wa barakallahu feekum wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi.